midnight, 31st July, 1838, slavery was ended in the British Caribbean.
What happened to the people after they were freed? What did they do? Did they just carry on working on the plantations?
Some did, some didn't. Everybody's story is different. It depends upon where they lived and what skills they had. One thing is for sure. After emancipation, the planters and the freed people had to find a new way of living together or living apart.
Who are these people?
These are people who live in the Caribbean today. Their family stories take us behind what the history books tell us. We can see some of the choices people had and the differences between them.
What happened to your family?
My great-great-grandmother was a slave whose name was Baba. She had a child from the plantation manager, John Field. My great-grandfather was a slave, and he was born in 1827.
So what happened to him after slavery was abolished?
In 1850, my great-grandfather was left 150 pounds by the plantation owner for his support and 150 pounds upon becoming 21, from which he bought 3 plantations. By the end of the 19th century, my family had become rich.
What about your family?
My mother's great-great-grandmother was a slave. She had been a slave on Kensington Estate in southern St. James. My grandfather was born in 1850 in St. Anne. His father was a policeman, and I would imagine as well, like a small farmer, few acres of land.
And what about your family?
My grandfather, he was a master mason eventually. He had 10 children, of which my mother was one. And they lived in the country, and they had land, and they grew their own crops.
Okay. What I don't understand is, if they weren't given land, how could they afford to buy it?
They had to earn money in any way they could. Often that meant leaving the island for work elsewhere.
They went in very large numbers to what is now Guyana. They went to Trinidad. First they went to the nearer islands, migrated to work on the land. And then they went into South America to help build railways, and they went to build the Panama Canal. And the money they sent back helped their families to acquire land, or at least improve their conditions. You see, they had lived all their lives on a plantation, never owned any land, and so the great dream was to own land.
What's going on here?
The church bought up land and then parceled it out in small lots so people could afford it. By 1860, 50,000 families had left the plantations in Jamaica and set up small farms. If they couldn't buy it, sometimes people moved on to land which was lying empty. This was called squatting.
So did everyone end up with land?
No, most people didn't make enough money, and on the smaller islands, there wasn't much land available anyway. In Barbados, people even had houses which they could move around because they owned no land. The chattel houses were built so that they could be completely taken apart and carried on a cart to the next place where work was available. They were put up on piles of stone, like this.
Okay, so all that happened before you were born. What was it like when you were growing up?
ordinary people, their children, used to go into the fields and work for a penny to 4 cents a day, depending on the period. I remember my grandfather chastising a superintendent of the third-class gang for attempting to flog a child with a whip. That was in the 1930s.
I thought things were supposed to get better after slavery was abolished.
The islands were still really run by the same people who had run them under slavery. They weren't that interested in making things better for ordinary people.
Can I speak to someone? Who's this?
This is Marcus Garvey.
I grew up in the countryside in Jamaica. I left school when I was 14 and went to work as a printer. Conditions was very hard, and I knew from very early on that I wanted to try and improve things.
So what did you do?
I got involved with the trade union. We went on strike for more money. I was the leader of the strike, and because of that, them sacked me at the end of the strike. I got another job. While I was working there, I printed my own newspaper for black people to help spread the message that we deserve better conditions.
Did that work?
It was not enough. I had to earn more money so I could campaign more. I left Jamaica and went to Costa Rica to work on a banana plantation. As I traveled around, I could see more and more how badly my people were being treated because they were black. And then I realized no white man will ever regard a black man as an equal. I read Up From Slavery by Booker T. Washington. And then I asked, where is the black man's government? Where is his king and his kingdom? Where is his president, his country, his ambassadors, his army, his navy, his men of big affairs? I couldn't find them. Then I decided I will help to make them. I had a vision of a new world of black men, not serfs, dogs, and slaves, but a nation of sturdy men, making their mark upon civilization and causing a new light to dawn upon the human race. My brain was afire with the possibility of uniting all the Negro peoples of the world into one great body to establish a country and a government absolutely their own.
In 1914, Marcus Garvey set up the Universal Negro Improvement Association.
Why then should we lose hope? Black men, you were once great, and you shall be great again. Lose not courage. Lose not faith. Go forward. Up, you mighty race, you can accomplish what you will.
Garvey encouraged people to go back to Africa. In Jamaica, in his lifetime, he was often regarded as a troublemaker.
What did you think about Marcus Garvey?
We knew very little about Marcus Garvey as a child growing up. I was 13 years old when his body was returned from London, where he had died in 1940. It was then we found out what Garvey had meant to so many people in Jamaica in terms of self-love, self-pride, self-reliance, the importance of achievement and hard work.
Perhaps the hardest task in the world is to fight against the kind of prejudice that takes hold of the human heart and mind. To fight to free men from this kind of prejudice is an agonizing task, as Marcus Garvey discovered.
What's this?
This is people rioting in the 1930s.
Well, in 1937, people were so frustrated and angry and miserable that it was just an outpouring of frustration.
there were riots in many islands. The depression of the 1930s was hard for many people. In the Caribbean, unemployment rose and wages were cut.
So what happened after that?
After the strikes in the 30s, the British government set up a committee to look into conditions in the Caribbean.
Moyne Commission, 1938.
Many of the houses are made of rusty, corrugated iron and unsound boarding.
Every condition that tends to produce disease is here.
The Moyne Commission made recommendations to improve things in the Caribbean. The recommendations included everything from better housing to more jobs.
Did it make things better?
Yes. But Britain couldn't really afford to sort out the problems it had created in the Caribbean. Some Jamaicans began to look for other answers, not to Britain, but to Africa.
What does that mean?
Africa, unite, 'cause we're moving right out of Babylon, and we're going to our father's land.
In the 30s, a group of people got together in Jamaica. They called themselves Rastafarians. They encouraged black people to be proud of themselves and their links with Africa.
Africa, yeah. Has it been said already?
Can I speak to someone?
This is our flag with the lion inside of it. The red is the spiritual aspect of our life. Church triumphant. The gold is the wealth of the earth. And the green is the lush vegetation that we have to live off. Another strong symbol of a Rastaman is his drums. When they were carrying black people away from Africa, over to the Western world, they banned our drums. They did not like to hear the sound of the drums at all. So, our drums is very important. Our drums unite us together. Marcus Garvey is a prophet within the Rastafari tradition. We hold Marcus Garvey as very sacred. As a matter of fact, we refer to him as Saint Marcus Garvey, one of the greatest leaders of the world.
Returning to Africa is the major aim of most Rastas.
What? Going back to live in Africa? Why?
Africa is the black man's homeland. It's his pride. It's his heart is in Africa. Although we have lived in this part of the world, we have never lost sight of our goal of Africa.
What did other Caribbean people think? Did they all want to go back to Africa?
I don't think that most people thought that way. What they wanted to see was that black people right here where they are should have a better deal.
These are some of the thousands of Caribbean people who fought for Britain in the Second World War.
Just after the war was when my granddad left the Caribbean. That's when he came to Nottingham.
Yes, a lot of people went to Britain then. Caribbean people were encouraged to go and work there. But they also found poorly paid jobs and racism there.
Sir, I am a Jamaican.
Find it difficult to get a job because of the color of my
4,000 odd West Indians unemployed in Nottingham.
My granddad came to work as a bricklayer. What did you do when you came here?
I went to England in the 1950s to do a course in building construction to qualify as a builder. When I was there, there were 10 members of my family in Britain. Some had already qualified or being qualified as doctors. There were lawyers, and I was doing building construction.
I taught in a school in England. I was the first black teacher they'd had. If you're a black person in England, you can't forget it. It is in subtle ways, if you see what I mean. When you were looking for somewhere to live, there was always a problem because people heard your voice and they said yes, they had accommodation, and when they saw you, it suddenly, they didn't have it anymore. That kind of thing.
What's this?
Back home, people began to question why they were ruled by a foreign land. People in the Caribbean started to talk more about independence from Britain so they could govern themselves.
Up until the 1950s in Jamaican schools, nothing was taught called Jamaican history, or for that matter, Caribbean history or geography. Whatever was done was related to an aspect of English history.
Caribbean people still had little power. Britain had not made any real changes to the way they were ruled.
The pattern of life is the same as it was 300 years ago, and it is still the descendants of the slaves who do the work in the sugar field.
At one time, the Caribbean used to be called the slums of the British Empire. It was felt that more should be done to give opportunities for people to live better, improve themselves, and develop themselves.
Jamaica became independent in 1962, and Barbados in 1966.
Brothers and sisters, enjoy and praise Mr. Alexander. Alexander! Brothers and sisters, you joy and praise to Mr. Manny. Don't be sad and blue. The Lord is still with you. Because the time has come when you can have your fun, Jamaica run. Because the time has come when you can have
so,
your fun.
So, has life changed?
Independence coincided with opportunity for us. As a child, I never knew running water in a house or electricity until I was 7. In fact, I still recall the first time we moved to Kingston, being mesmerized by the light bulb. I actually screwed the bulb out and pushed my finger up the socket to find out what made it work and got a terrible shock. So in that regard, Jamaica has improved a lot in terms of social facilities as well as institutions like healthcare and education.
For the first time, Caribbean people ruled themselves.
Because the time has come when you can have your fun, Jamaica run. Because the time has come when you can have your fun.